Come on in. Ready? Yeah. Are you ready, Sambo?
Yeah, are you ready?
Hello, good afternoon, good morning, good evening. I'm Tony from Tommy's Yard. And what I've got to do today, I'm going to fit a radiator on the wall. So I'm going to show you how to fit a radiator from start to finish. So bear with me while I'm doing it. I'll try to talk you through every step as I'm doing it. If there's something I do, and you're not understanding why I'm doing it or I haven't explained it properly, just drop us a comment and we'll try and come back to you and answer any of your questions. Right, so this is the rad. Now, I'll first start off by talking about our pipes. These are our pipes that come through the wall. They are our flow and return pipes. Now, I'll put them pipes in so I know what distance apart they needed to be and how high they needed to be to take our skirting underneath. Right, this radiator is a 900 by 600 rad. So I've set my pipes at 980. Just to give us enough room for our valves and the drain off and stuff like that, and playing around just to get the pipe work nice and neat. Right, so our rad. These are rads that have come from, where did we get these from, Sam?
Tommy's Yard.
These come from Tommy's Yard, good boy.
Of course.
And we've got an order in. When did this come in, this rad, Sam? Was this the one that...
Yeah.
Right. Now, in your rad, what are you going to have in the packet? You should have some fixing kits in the packet, in the rad casing. You'll always get a fixing kit like that, and I'll talk you through what that is in a minute. Open up your rad, I'm using a knife here. If you're a little unconfident of using it, don't use a knife. If you are, open up the rad from the bottom end. Don't do it from the top, because these have got grills on. So if you go through with your knife, obviously you're going to damage your rad. Right, so bear with me while I'm just opening it up. It's pretty boring. Not much to tell you about opening the rad up, is there? It's like opening a present, I suppose, isn't it?
Yeah.
You like opening presents, Sam?
I love opening presents.
You do, don't you?
Yeah.
Right. Be careful of this part. Lots of damage to the radiator. Which obviously now be filmed, I'll do. The central heating system in this house, which we fitted, it's all been pressure tested up. It was actually pressure tested, we left it on for about a week while we were working in it, just so we know we've got no leaks. When I say pressure tested, there's a couple of pressure tests you can do. You can do air test or water test. We always do a water test because obviously it's going to have water running through it. But yeah, so that's that. But yeah, it's been left on for about a week, so there's no water in this. We'll just drain it back out again. Obviously, if you are fitting a radiator in your property, then you've got to drain your central heating down, which we'll show you about in another how-to. Because it sometimes can be a little bit complicated, all depends on what sort of system you've got. Right, radiator, here we go. I'll get a bit closer there, sir.
Bit too close.
Bit too close for your liking.
Yeah.
You're putting everything over in the cupboard there for a minute, rubbish. Because obviously, Sam will clear it up later. And out of the way. Nice clear area as well, you want. You don't want everything on top of you. Just get all your tools ready, which I've done down here, Sam. I think that's everything I'll need. That's my plumbing, obviously my plumbing box and my tool bag. My plumbing box is a little bit dirty there actually, isn't it? Mm. But we've been at it. Right, radiator. So, as I was saying earlier in the pack, you've got your brackets and you've got your fixing kits and stuff. Right, first thing I'm going to show you how to do is how to get your rad in the position so it's central to your pipes. Now, there's a lot of different ways to do this. This is the way I was shown to do it, and I find it most effective and the easiest way. I'll turn that around for you. On the back of your rad, you've got some brackets. Now these is obviously where your wall brackets sit. So what you want to do, you want to position your wall brackets in the centre of these. Because then if you don't get your measurements quite spot on, you can move the rad a little bit. You've got this much play in your radiator. Right. What you want to do, look at your centre. Mark the rad up. Just a little pencil mark in the centre. Again, in the centre. So we know that's the centre of our brackets on our radiator. That's where our wall brackets are going to be. Offer your radiator up so that's central to your pipes. I've got the tape measure in my pocket. So what now that we can do is measure up. I've got 35mm thereabouts that side. I'll do the same with this side. I've got 25, so I need to go over that way 10mm. Which isn't much, so I'll just gently give it a nudge. Okay. 35, isolated. See, I've gone a little bit too much on that one. So I'll just pull it back just a little bit. 30. Right, that's where I need to be with my rad. If you have a look, can you get that in shot, Sam? My rad is central to my pipes. So I now know that's where I need my rad to be. Now I've marked the radiator up, centre of the brackets on the back of the rad. So now what I need to do is just put a little mark. I'll come over this side, Sam, for you. A little mark on the wall, the same, there and there. So now I know my brackets, wall brackets, are going to be in the centre of my radiator brackets. It's easy to do. Next thing. Some radiators are different, but I'll talk you through this one. Determine your height of your rad. So these brackets up. Determine the height, right. What you need to do is this. That's your wall bracket. So that sits onto your radiator, like so. Now, determine the height of your radiator. You need to get your tape measure, and you need to measure down from the bottom of the bracket to the floor. So what I'm doing here, I now know, right, 50 mil. So wherever I hang these brackets on the wall, my radiator, the bottom of it, is going to finish 50 mil below those brackets. Some radiators are different, so don't take that 50 mil for your radiator. Your radiator might be 80 mil, might be 70 mil, might be 60 mil. Mine's 50. Right, I know how high I need to put my rad in, but what you want to do, if you want your radiator to finish in line with your pipes, so you'll have a straight rad valve coming out your rad and straight into your pipe, you need to put your wall brackets 50 mil above your pipe. So you would put a line, go from your pipe, go 50 mil, and then you'll put a line right the way through the wall. I'll show you how to do it the way I'm going to do it, but I'm just saying for this rad if I want it in line. So 50 mil, a line straight through. You know that your radiator is going to be dead in level with them pipes there. Now I want to come up a little bit with mine, because we've got angled rad valves to go. That's the way I've set these pipes up, to take angled rad valves. So I'm going to come up a little bit more. I'm going to come up 100 mil from my pipe work. From the top of my pipe, 100 mil. Right, now get me level. There you go, 100 mil from the top of my pipe work. I've got a nice long level, which is nice and clean actually, because Brad used it the other day to level floor off. Make sure you're nice and level when you do this line. Take your time to do it and get it right, because this is going to determine if your rad is on the wall level or not. Alright, I'm bang on there. So I'm going to put a line all the way through. Now, where do I need to put my wall brackets? Remember the mark we put on the wall? Both sides, which was in the middle of our bracket on our radiator. There and there. So again, I'll take it level. I'll offer it up to our line, little line we put. Make sure I'm plumb. Again, make sure this is level. Take your time doing this. I'm level, bang on level. Come here, Sam, have a look at this level. People ain't too familiar with a level. You want your bubble to be sitting in between these little two little lines here. That looks pretty much spot on. So now what I want to do is put a line from your line, we put that way, your horizontal line, now I want to go vertical, up the wall. Replicate that on this side. That floor's going a bit there, Sam, do you see that? We've had the floor scrapers in, but they've missed a little bit here. Again, take your time to do this. Do it right. And you've only got to do it once then. Once your radiator's up, you ain't got to mess about taking your brackets off. Right, now I've got my markings on the wall. So remember how we done that? 100 mil up from your pipe, because I want my radiator, the bottom of my radiator, to sit higher than them pipes. So 100 mil up, level it. I've already got my mark on the wall, which we got from putting a mark on the radiator. Two straight lines down the wall. That's really simple to do. Your bracket, your wall bracket. All radiator wall brackets come with two different sides on them. A deeper side and a shallower side. It all depends how far your pipes come out of the wall, or if you want your rad to come out of the wall a little bit more. It all depends what side you'll use. In this instance, so look, can you see that, Sam? Can you work out that's deeper on it than that?
Yeah.
So obviously if I'm putting that on the wall that way, that's shallower. If I turn it around, that's deeper.
Yeah.
Now remember, when you put your bracket on the wall, your lugs, which your rad sits into, need to be that way up.
Pointing upwards.
Pointing upwards. If they're that way around, your rad's just gonna drop off, isn't it? Simple. So just bang, it clips into there. So remember I said I wanted my rad the short way round. So I'm gonna put them on like this. Another little tip as well, and this is just the way I do it. Because I don't want to catch myself out, I suppose. Whatever bracket you use to mark up now, use that bracket again in that position. So I've got that one there and that one there. But what I want to do is just make sure I'm going to have it around the right way. Yeah. Go that way. That one. And that way for that one. That way for that one, yeah. Yeah, good. Right. So, right, what I was just saying, your wall bracket. I'm going to use this wall bracket to mark up this line. You offer your wall bracket up to your two lines, your horizontal and vertical lines, which you've marked on your wall. So the bottom of the wall bracket is going to be finishing with your line there, and then line your wall bracket up with your line, your vertical line there. You can, if you like, use these markings here, which then you've got the opportunity to slide your bracket up and down. I don't need to do that because I know I've got it in at the right height. If you're a little bit unsure, you can use these, and then you've got the opportunity to slide your bracket up and down. I really never do, because what I don't want is putting my fixings in there, and then over time, if people leaning on the rad and stuff like that, your fixings loosen up, your rad's going to start dropping off the wall, creating leaks, and then you're going to have to call someone like me around. Right, so mark that up there. Take your time on this again, make sure you're right. Mark that one up there, mark that one up there. I'm going to leave that bracket there. Because, look, they're all machine made, they're all made in a factory. But if the holes, for some reason, are off, if I use that bracket to mark that one up and that one up, when I come to put this bracket on, if the holes are off, they're not going to meet. So use the bracket for the sides you're going to actually fix it to. Just do the same again on this side. Mark up your horizontal and vertical lines. Take your time, get it right. There's my two marks. So, that's the marking I've done of your rad. Nice and easy. I'll get my drill, I've got my fixings and stuff ready. They supply fixings with these rads, but I always use our own. We've got Timcos, which we use all the time. They're fantastic screws. We use them for everything, balding, putting rads up, putting floors down. There's a big selection of them they do. They do screws that you don't need raw plugs with and stuff like that. We use them all the time, but they're brilliant screws and they work better. I just like them. They seem a little bit tougher than the ones which come on. Right, that's my two holes there. Red plugs, 6mm plugs, running the mill plugs with the Fishers. A lot of different companies again make these. I like these plugs. You can get some plugs which are split at the ends and they're not very good. I find these ones really good. I've used them for years. So you put your plugs into the wall. Keep dancing around this hand, don't you?
Yeah.
You got any questions, Sam? I've not mentioned so far, something I mentioned? Or I've covered everything you think so far?
I think we're doing alright at the moment.
Yeah, I'm doing alright. I went on a course today this year.
Yeah? One day.
If you have a look at our Facebook page, this is more jokey side of us, we'll find out how long the courses I went on. Go on our Facebook, get it, and I'll tell you. Right, screws with brackets. We'll put these up on the wall. Again, I've not done nothing here really that most people shouldn't be able to do. I'm going to offer that up. Put the screw in. Put the screw in.
What size screw would you recommend, Tom? Go through
these. These are 6mm. These are 50mm, and I'm using 50mm screws here. Or they're 70s actually. Let me just double check that. I'm not going to give you the wrong information. 50s, yeah, they are. I'm using 50s. These walls are quite thin in this property. We've had a couple of problems, to be honest with you, with how thin the walls are when we're working in rooms next door, because we've just put a little back addition on it. Just be careful. In actual fact, Sam, that is a very good question. If you are going to be using your own fixings, all the fixings supplied, be careful that you've got a thin wall and you're not going to use a big, massive screw to go through your wall. You'll end up out the other side and you'll have to use it for a coat or something. But you don't want to be doing that, because then you'll have to pull someone like Brad round to make it good.
Tom, can I be a plumber?
Sorry, mate?
Can I be a plumber? I'm busted, bro.
You're knackered.
See the back of my side of my knee?
Look. How many square metres that day, mate?
About a square mile, mate.
About a square mile. Oh, yeah.
Mate, I'm fatigued now.
Are you getting it?
Yeah.
You feeling it?
I'm now.
He ain't stopped, Brad. Ain't stopped. Where's he? I'm not going to blame Charlie while he's in here. But he ain't stopped since 7 o'clock this morning.
He's only half 7 now.
It's 4 to 8. We're going to our tea break. Right, what I'm doing now, I'm just tapping my plugs in a little bit, which you should always do. Don't want your plugs sitting right at the end, pull them out, so just give them a little tap in. Impact driver I'm using. You could use a hand screwdriver, but as you can see, I'm quite lazy. Feel that in. That's it. Screw that in. That's it, that's my brackets on. So, I mean, even you could do that, Sam.
I know, and I'm special.
You are quite special, actually, yeah. You could do that. Right, now, your fitting pack, which I was speaking about earlier. You got your plugs. I mean, look at them plugs, they're terrible. These tend to snap, the bolts you get with them. The ends of them tend to snap off. They're soft, soft metal. They ain't no good. So I'll put them over there and sand clean up later. We don't want to use them, get rid of them. I'm not really this messy normally, but I just want everything out of the way. Right, what have we got in here? Little pack. You get these kind of little, what would you call them, Sam? What would you call them?
Teeth.
You would call them teeth?
They look like
Is that what you call them, teeth?
Like a
row of
teeth.
What sort of teeth? They might look like teeth. What are those little securing pieces for your radiator to sit onto your bracket? Metal on metal, it's going to be scratching about and stuff. It just gives you that little softer seating. So these, you just snap them off. Sometimes they don't come like teeth, as Sam said. They come all singly. These ones, you just snap them off. And then your bracket, which we fitted on the wall, the right way up, all you do is just slide them in, like that. All four, you get four, well actually they give you more than four. Teeth, you give more teeth, Sam, is that what they are, teeth?
More than four teeth.
More than four teeth.
Just in case.
Just in case you lose a tooth.
Exactly.
Right, so I'm just putting these in now. Nothing to explain really more about these. They just slot in. You slot these in with your fingers. They're done. I've got two spare teeth, Sam.
Lovely.
Right. What should I talk you through? Right, fitting pack. As we're on the fitting pack, I'll talk you through that. In here, you'll get these with all radiators. And if you don't get these, you're going to have a problem. What you've got here is a blanking cap for one side of your rad. And you've got... Did you get a look at that, Sam? Was I too quick? Blanking cap. Just looks like that. And then what you've got is your side for your vent, where you bleed your radiator from. New radiators all come with bleed valves like that, where you can also do them with a bleed key, or you can do them with a screwdriver, a flat screwdriver. It don't really matter which way you put these on, to be honest with you. There's no set way. It's got to be on this side or this side. If you're fitting your own rad, whatever way you want to put it on, I'll put it on the right-hand side. Come on, mate.
I grew hair.
You look like something out of the 90s with a flat top.
Oi, I used to have a haircut on that rock.
What, flat top?
Flat top rock.
Good job.
Every week I've got a green.
Have a trim.
Have a trim up, mate. You need a big comb on me.
Yeah. Right, all I'm doing here is taking out the transit bolts, if you like. They're just caps. They put in the rags when they're testing them and when they're powder coating them. They're just a cap like that. Some of them are screwing, some of them aren't. Just take them out, get rid of those. Fit these now. All of these as well come with the rubbers already on them. You can see that. That should come on that. If it don't, you've got a problem. It might have come off in a pack somewhere. Have a look through it. You'll need that because when you fill your system up, it'll just absolutely pour out the water. So you just wind this in by hand for the minute. Get your adjustables on it. I'm using adjustables. I do use adjustments quite a lot, obviously, being a plumber. But we've done a how to change your, tap washer.
Yeah.
And I've used a pair of pump pliers to undo the tap washer. The guy pulled this up, didn't he? Mm. Right, doing that up. Do that up just till it's enough. Don't over-tighten it. Obviously, it's a rubber washer in there, so it's going to stop the water. Just give it until you can feel a little bit of resistance on there. Don't go crazy with it. Don't use nothing mechanical on it. Just a pair of grips. This side, the same goes in as that side. Wind it in by your hand, get your adjustables. Again, nine on straight away. As soon as you wind it in hand tight, you'll feel that give in. Right, that's a give there, that's enough. That's my radiator for the minute set up. So now, this is only a little rag, so I can lift it myself. I can offer it up to my brackets. The way I do this, which is the easiest way, I think, because obviously you've got to try to, those little teeth, as Sam called them, they're obviously sit like that, so you've got to try and clip your rad into it. So the way I do it is this. Offer your rad up, go in at the bottom. So you're secure now, I can hold that, it's only a little rad, I can hold it. Pull it up, and then just lift it onto the top. That's it, that's my rad hung on the wall. Now that's easy, anyone can do that. So now what I want to do again, just have a look, have a brush, you alright mate? What I want to do is centralise my radiator again. Remember, I've got a little bit of movement on them brackets, so I'm just going to centralise it again. Being where I need to be. Take my tape measure out, have a quick measure up, see where I am. 30 mil. Just a little tap. That way for my liking, just a little bit. Right. So, next move, what you need to do is this. Bottom of your rad, where I'm going to fit my lock shield and TRV. These are the lock shields and TRVs we're using. Again, these were supplied by
Tommy Jarve,
well done, Sam.
Thermostatic radiator valve.
Well done, Sam. What's
the TRV is?
TRV, thermostatic radiator valve. In a pack like this, sometimes they come singly. All packs we sell come with your TRV and lock shield. TRV, what's a TRV? Thermostatic radiator valve. This will help you control the temperature of your radiator in your house. Nearly every single radiator in your house will have one of these on, should have one of these on, apart from one. Now that one which doesn't have one on will be by your room thermostat. Because obviously your room thermostat determines your setting, which your unit determines the heat in your house. So if you want it 30 degrees, you're going to turn it up to 30 degrees. But if you've got a radiator with a TRV on it, in your hallway where your room stat is, and that TRV is turned down to number one, but you're trying to draw 30 degrees of heat, it's not going to happen because your rad's not going to heat up to 30 degrees. So that's what TRV does. It determines the heat of your radiator. There's 1 to 5 on them. They're all 1 to 5. There's loads of different brands of these you can get. It's customer preference really on this. They can go up from, how much are these ones, Sam? Roughly.
8 quid,
and go up from a tenner to 30, 40, 50 quid. So it's your preference, what one you want to use. They all do the same job. Having said that, they all do the same job. That's a lie, actually. They all do the same job in theory, but if you're going for one of these newfangled Wi-Fi systems, you have to have a certain rad valve. But if you haven't, you're not going to be trying to be too flash. Any rad valve will do. Right, now. Universal, these are universal rad valves. So So it doesn't matter if you fit it on the flow or the return. You can either or, don't matter. I know my flow is on the left. We always put them on the left. So I'm going to fit this on the return on the right. It don't really matter. I can fit it on the flow if I like to, the flow of the heating coming. It doesn't matter. So how do you fit these? In this radiator here, we've got to add a little cap again. Again, for when it was being tested and stuff. This one's a pull-out one. Again, it might be a screwed one. So you just pull it out, get rid of it. Now, how do I fix this in here to make it watertight? This is the way you do it. You find your PTFE, which is there, and your boss white. Not everyone does it this way, it's the way I do it. And I find it the way where you're gonna minimize your chance of getting a leak. So remember, if you're fitting your thermostatic radiator valve onto this side of the rad, just make sure you've got the right valve for it. I know it's this one because that's a lock shield. See, the heads are different on them. That goes onto the top there. Right, so this is your dart, your radiator dart. You want to take that off. And what you want to do is get your PTFE, wrap it around your dart. Let me just pull that back a bit, sir. You want your PTFE starting off, you want it starting off so it's flat, like that. As flat as you can get it, anyway. Right. Now I'm going to wrap that around the dart. This stuff is, every plumber will have this stuff in their boxes. I've got it laying around everywhere. In my plumbing box, I've got it, let me pull that off because the end of it ain't no good to be honest. I've got it in my plumbing box, I've got it in my toolbox, it's down the door of the van, it's everywhere. I go home and it gets left in my trousers. Right, so I'm wrapping that around there now. You want to go around about 8 times, you don't want to overdo it. There's a fine line between overdoing it and not enough. If you don't do enough, you're going to cause a leak. If you overdo it, you're going to cause a leak. Because what you're going to do, you're going to bend your thread on your rad. So, there we go, that's wrapped around. Again, nice and neat, nice and easy. I'll show you that. Oh, I just rub my finger around it. So that's what it looks like. Now, a lot of plumbers would stop there. They would fit that, and that would be enough for them. For me, it's not. I'll get a bit of Boss White. There's loads of different, this is a leak sealer. There's loads of different types of this. This is the one I use for central heating systems. Again, it was because it was what I was taught to use this stuff. This one you can't use on potable water. This is for non-potable water. So any drinking water, you can't use this Boss White. I think it's Hawk White, which you use on potable water. And it's good stuff. It's really good stuff. It smells to high heavens. Yeah, look, have a sniff of that. Can you smell that?
Oh yeah, they can smell that.
You can smell that, yeah? It stinks to high heavens, it's greasy, it's horrible, it's oily, but it does the job and it does the job effectively. So this, I'm going to put on my thread, on my rad. So I'm going to get a bit out on the end of my finger. Again, there's loads of different types of leak sealer, joint sealer you can get. This is my preferred choice. On potable water, my preferred choice is Fernox LSX. Right, so I'm going to rub that now, just in my thread. Don't overdo it, just rub it in there. So I'm filling up the thread. Not loads and loads as I was explaining before. Just filling my thread up nice. Can you get in there, Sam?
Yes.
Yeah? Right. Now get your dart, offer it up. Start doing it up by hand. There we go, until you can't do it anymore. I'll get my adjustables, which I've gone in my pocket. And I'll start doing this dart up. Now, if I can get a little bit more on that. The dart, how fast are you going with the dart? You want to go in with the dart, really, until it stops moving anymore. Once you'll know on this, when you've done enough, it will stop, basically. If now, you couldn't stop now because you've got a high chance of that leaking. So just wind that in, keep going with it. Nothing fancy about that. I'm nearly there. I just felt it go nearly. Right, I'm there. That's it wound in. That's that dart wound in. Nice and easy being done. Now, I want to offer up my valve. Onto it there. So the next thing I need to do is offer my valve up nice like that. I'm going to get myself a T. In this instance, am I going to use a T or should I not? I'll put the drain on the other side. Right. 15mm elbow. Again, you've probably all seen them before. I'm looking for a bit of white wool. Where's that bit of white wool, Sambo?
Not actual, mate.
No, I know there's some in there.
Uh-huh.
There's some in the other room.
Is there? Whereabouts?
Far through.
Oh, sorry, I've got it. Right. Again, this is all clients have this laying about all the time. Same as PTFE. Steel wool, we call it wire wool. My pipe here, I want to give it a bit of a clean up. It's been in that situation there. It's been in the situ for a couple of weeks. So it's had plaster on it. And what else? So give me pipe a clean up. You should always give me pipe a little bit of a clean up. Elbow. Ready, 15mm elbows, 15mm pipe coming through the wall. What I've got to do, bit of flux on there. We've shown you some how-tos, how to do a bit of soldering. But I'll tell you again quickly, a little bit of flux in your fitting, not too much, you don't have to overdo it. The flux is just to make sure when you heat it up, it cleans your copper, helps your solder run. That's out of my fitting. I want to go on like that. Now, my bit of pipe I need to go from the valve to the elbow. I know my bit of pipe stops just there where that arrow is. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to measure from my pipe fitting there to just inside my valve, which is 70mm. So my 15mm copper, I'll get cutters into there. Pipe slice, I think we spoke about these quite a few times. It's the, I'll say it's a new way of doing it, not new now, they've probably been out 25 years old, I imagine. 20 years. 70mm. There we go, 70mm. The way I know that's 70mm is the line on your pipe slice, in the middle of my pipe slice, that's where your cut is going to be. So I've measured 70mm from the end of my pipe to the middle of my pipe slice. So I'm 70mm on that, hopefully. This is my nut, which goes onto my valve, and that's my olive. You want to make sure you're fitting your olive all the time, your brass olive. If you don't fit that, all you've got to do is crimp all your pipe work and cause a leak. That will hunker down on the pipe, and it'll stop any water leaking out. Right, fit that onto there. That onto there. And that's my valve, and piped up. Ready to go, ready to solder. Again, nothing was too hard there, was it? Take your time doing it. Make sure your measurements are on. Make sure your measurements are right. Soldering. Where's my solder, Sam, bud?
In there.
Solder, you want to be using lead-free solder. You don't want to be using, you can use leaded solder, to be honest with you, on this central heating system. But. No plumber really carries leaded solder now, it's all lead free. Soldering. Alright, heat up the fitting. You just want to hold your torch as steady as you can on your fitting for 20-30 seconds, all depends how cold it is out really, how cold the pipe is. And this comes with experience when you'll know you're ready to start soldering. Done. Right, this is face work solder, so you want to be pretty spot on with it. I always rub a little bit of flux around the pipe, around the solder joint, cools the solder down, helps it run a little, the last little bit, just in case you've missed a little bit of it. That's that solder. Now what you want to do is get your cloth, your damp cloth. When you're soldering, always have a damp cloth with you. Cool your fitting down as soon as you've soldered it. Also, to clean that flux now off, because I don't want that flux sitting on the pipe, it go green, it corrodes, it looks horrible. So this is gonna be hot. You probably ain't picked that up, that it was hissing. So this is a damp cloth. So what I'm doing here, I'm doing two things. I'm cleaning my fitting, and I'm cooling it down. Right, that's that side, done. I ain't gonna tighten it up yet. And you shouldn't either really, even though I've cooled that down, give that time to cure. Give that a couple of minutes just to let itself settle down a bit. Right, we're gonna be doing this side now, Sam, so you wanna come around here. Again, repeat the process really. Repeat the process on this side, what you've done on that side. It's the same thing, even though that's a TRV and that's a lock shield, it's exactly the same process. So I've got my dart, and that's a lock shield. It's not got the big thermostat head on it. That's a lock shield. Again, loads of different types of them. You can get again with chrome heads, and you can get brass ones, you can get antique looking ones. This is what we've gone for, the customer's gone for here. So again, I'm just gonna pull my plug out my rad. I might be able to get a better shot in there from that angle actually, Sam, what you did for that one. I'll show you the boss white. So this is my boss white, which I've already spoke about. Going on my thread. I'm just going to rub that on my thread. Be careful when you're doing this, because sometimes you get a few burrs of metal in there. Sticking your fingers out a little bit, but... make sure you wash your hands after you use this stuff. And all. Because it's what do you think that's like? It's very much like putty, Sam, isn't it? Smell that?
Oh. Yeah.
It's like putty, isn't it? Like a strong putty. I'm just going to rub that in. Again, not overdo it. Take off any excess. That's that done. Again, PTFE on my dart. Remember what I said at the beginning. If you think I've missed anything out, anything important to you, or I've missed out along the way of doing this, or I've not covered it properly, just comment and we'll get back to you. Sam will probably comment, come back to you. He'll ask me or Brad, and then he'll come back to you. But we're trying to help as much as we can. That's my PTFE on my dart. Again, in my hand tight. My adjustables on it. Tighten it up. Remember, you want to tighten this up until it stops. Again, you'll know, same with your blanking plate up there, you'll know when it's enough. If you underdo it, it'll just leak, and it just causes problems, because what'll happen is you'll have to drain all your system down. And what I didn't explain, actually, is why I use PTFE and Boss White. I use them both just to save myself any problems. I've got two leak sealers on there, joint sealers. I've used the Boss White and the PTFE, a little bit of each. You know, you've got a minute of having a leak. The worst thing in the world being a plumber is fitting a brand new system up, pumping it all up, and then bang, one of these spring a leak. You've got to then drain down the whole system. So do that, it takes a minute more to do it, and you're just going to save yourself so much aggro in the long run. Right, lock shield. Lock shield can go on. What I'm going to do on this one as well, is I'm going to fit a drain off on this one. So, why do I want to fit a drain off on this one? Personally, I think drain off should be on every radiator. Every radiator I fit, I'll put a drain off on. Every new system I install, I'll put a drain off on every rad. I'll also put a drain off on the flow and return wherever my boiler is. And that's not really for me, that's for the customer and for the next plumber that comes along. If he's got a leak on this rad, he can drain it out from here. If you've got a leak on the boiler or in the boiler cupboard, you can drain it down from there. If it's got a leak on the rad in the next room, you can drain it from there, wherever you like. They're not an eyesore if you do them properly. If you have them sticking out here or over here, they look horrible. But I'll show you the way I do them to try and minimise them looking awful, really. Where have we got this? Did I bring one in? Not sure if I've got one in, actually. Right, so... what I want to do here. I want to cut this pipe back. I'm going to fit a T in here because my drain off's going to fit into one side of that T. So I want to cut that pipe back quite a bit. Because I always go underneath the rad with a drain off. So I'm going to cut that back to about there. Again, offer your fitting up, whatever you're doing. Offer it up to your pipe, so you know where you're going to cut your pipe.
Yeah.
Russ, in that box by the front door, you couldn't grab a string off, could you?
No,
I'm busy. Cheers, mate. I thought I'd pick one up. I don't know where I put it. Sure, I'll pick one up. Like you know. Right, so... I've cut the pipe back. Now I'm going to give it a little bit of a clean up. As I said earlier, always give your pipe a little bit of clean up before you solder it. Just helps your solder run.
Helps for any problem.
Cheers, mate. I'm sure I brought one in, but maybe not. Right, so I've cleaned the pipe up. Now I've got the fitting. Now, if you bear with us on this one, it's quite an in-depth how-to, isn't it, Sam? There's a lot to fit in a radiator. It's not just a quick five-minute job if you want to get it right.
Yeah.
I could do this rad, to be honest, in half the time, but I'm talking you through it. And if you're doing this at home, by yourself, first time doing it, just take your time. No rush, is there? Got the tea piece on there. The drain off what Ross just finally got me. I'm going to fit so it's underneath the rad. Now, I just think they look neater. That's a drain off where your plumber will come along to drain the central heating system down from. That's what they look like. You've probably all seen them on your central heating system. If you haven't, go around, have a look. Make sure you know where they are. So if you do happen to get a leak, your plumber, when he turns up, you can tell him exactly where this is. Or do it yourself. Turn your water off to your property, completely off. If you've got a leak on your central heating system, turn your main stop clock off, open up all your taps, stick a hose onto the end here, and then just let that open. Not all the way open. You don't want to open that all the way up, because then you'll have water coming out of there as well. Just open it up enough till you start getting the water out of there. Obviously attach a hose to it and run it outside. You're just defeating the object, didn't you know? Right, so. Drain off in there, lovely. Tie on a little bit of pipe. What I'm going to stick in there. What I could do is actually pull that around a bit. What I'm going to do, Sam, is I'm going to solder that now. Am I going to solder that now? Yeah, why not? I'm going to solder that now. Because then what I can do is, once that's soldered and gone off, then I can take the measurement as I did on the other side, from my valve here down to my pipe. I know exactly the length of copper I need then, so I can cut the copper, offer it up, and cut this bit here. So let's solder that one on. How's that coming through the wall, Sam? Is it a bit...
No, it's alright.
Does it? Right, I'm going to solder this on. Obviously, I'm not using no burn mat here. We've got burn mats, but it's not going to affect anything. Again, with your soldering, this all comes down to experience. You don't want to be using too much solder, just enough to seal it. As long as it's sealed, it's enough. On face work, anyway. You've probably heard me saying time and time again, on work, under floors or in stud walls, go over the top of it. I always do. See it drying up roads faster.
Yeah.
You're lucky for that, isn't he? How's that looking there, Sam?
All good, mate. All good.
Right, that's that soldered. Again, I'm going to run a bit of flux around it. You probably have and other people screaming at me, don't do it that way. It's the way I do it. If you don't do it that way, don't do it that way. I'll do it this way. I'm going to clean that up anyway. It just helps your solder run. Gives you a neater finish. And there. Cloth. Cool that down a bit. I'm going to work on this pretty quick. So I'm going to cool that down, because if I was to work on that too quick and I hadn't cooled it down, I want to cut this pipe in a second. If I try to cut this pipe too quick, it's going to crack my joint. Cause me problems, cause me leaks, which I don't want, if I can help it. Because we all get leaks. Any plumber who tells you you don't get a leak's a liar. It's the nature of the beast. If you're doing 1,000 solder joints a year, you're going to get a leak. Any plumber. And you do get them, you say, no, I'll never get a leak. I ain't had a leak for 20 years. You're a liar. Right, so I'm just going to cut a little bit of the end of this pipe off here. I'm going to cut it back here in a minute anyway. I'm going to offer that up. Now my fitting Oh no, my fitting. When you're cutting your copper pipe, your fitting obviously sits like that in your pipe. So I know, like, to measure my pipe, I fit my bit of copper on top of it. I know where it ends in that valve. But now, I just want to take a little bit off of that, actually. I weren't too far off that. Sometimes it can get a little bit tricky if you're trying to cut a bit of copper in your pipe slicers. Just grab your grips. Turn off of that upright. Grab your grips, hold your bit of copper. Spin that round. Just gonna pull that off a minute. See what I'm right there. Right, that's it, I'm pretty much spot on there with my cut. So that's where I know I need to be on my other cut. Again, what I've just said to you, your elbow will obviously sit on there like that. So now, how does that look, Sam? Does that, from your view there, does that pipe look like it's coming down straight? That one?
Yeah.
That's good, yeah?
Yeah.
I'm taking your word for it. Do you need to go back that way? Or back that way, or is that down straight?
Towards you a little bit.
Back towards me a little bit.
Yeah?
Yeah. We've got this on film, Sam, so if that's wrong, take me all over for it. Right, okay, it looked pretty good, actually. I could have done all this soldering in one hit if I wanted to, but if you see the way I'm doing it now, I ain't got to mess around with trying to hold that in there, because when you solder, sometimes your fittings drop out and stuff. I ain't got to mess around with none of that. That bit's done. That bit's solid now, so I know all I've got to do is one fitting. So again, flux it up. Don't know how to do it with a flux. A nice coating, but don't go mad. This system will get flushed through before it gets fired up anyway. So now, elbow onto my fitting. I'm gonna put my fitting on there. For me, that's the easiest way to do it. Because now I can just slide, hopefully, slide that onto there, give it a tap. That's on. Right, now that ain't gonna go nowhere now. All I've got to do is solder that one up. That ain't gonna go nowhere. So I've not got to worry about that dropping out being really quick, or I've not got the pipe in the fitting enough. That's perfect. Easy to, for me to solder. Soldering, you've seen me do that loads of times now. Probably getting bored of it. Heat your fitting up. Hottest part of your flame is the cone, the internal bit. You can pick it up, Sam. See that cone on the inside?
Yeah.
That's the hottest part of your flame. So you want the tip of your cone on your fitting, in the middle of the fitting. I'm heating my fitting up. This ain't gonna take that long to do. And if you're worried about these ones cracking, they won't. I'm heating this up. Yes, I'm gonna get heat transfer. There we go. Done. Again, I'll go with my flux. A little bit around it. A little bit around it. My cloth. Pull that down. Actually, what I didn't say to you, if you are fitting a drain off at home, on anything, a hot water system, cold water system, central heating system, when you're soldering, take out that part because it's got a rubber washer. And what will happen, if you solder that with that rubber washer in, the rubber washer's gonna melt. When you fill your system up, it's just gonna pour out water. That's cool enough now. It's warm, but it's cool enough now for me to put that back in. So I can do that up by hand. And then just knock that in. Right, my fittings on here and here. I'm just gonna tighten these up now. I'll go around again before I fill this system up, which we fitted. I'll go around again last minute and check all these, just in case someone thinks they're clever, wants to come along and undo them before we fill our system up. No names mentioned, but we've had it before. Right, that's me done up. This is your lock shield. This is obviously where you turn your radiator off from. Tell you all about them, excuse me, in another hour or two. Right, so that is basically it. That's my radiator fitting for the wall. Piped up, valves on. I think I've got to tighten this end up, haven't I, Sam?
Yeah.
I'll tighten this end up quickly, hand tight. What I'll do hand tight, done. And then I'm just going again with my pair of adjustables. Just go around again, do it until you feel a good bit of resistance on it. Don't over tighten it. You want to really be using adjustables on these crime fittings because your pump pliers will just scratch it to hell. Right, so that radiator is now done, fitted, ready to be filled up with water. I'm not going to fit my head of my TRV, but I can show you how it goes. We always leave these and don't fit them until right at the end because they always get paint on them and get knocked and stuff. That literally just screws onto there. So that's it, that's the radiator done, fitted on the wall, ready to go, ready to be filled up the water, ready for the system to be bled, all piped up. It wasn't that difficult to do. You can have a go at this yourself. If you think I have missed anything out, ask us a question, we'll come back to you and we'll try and help you as much as we can. Keep watching and we'll show you some other interesting stuff. Bye for now.